Hello, my name is Michael, and I'm the director, and... The film guy, the cameraman. Okay, well, hope you enjoy the rest.
Hi, I'm Mike, and this is my story. My mother's father was named Clayton Babineau. He was an alumni of Mass Maritime Academy and went on to work in the Merchant Marines. Unfortunately, I never got to meet him because nearly 4 years to the day before I was born, he died at sea. He was the first mate on the SS Marine Electric, which became an historic sinking that changed the Coast Guard and merchant marine industry forever. A book was written about this event, and in it can be found the precursors to my beginnings. My mother was the eldest of three siblings, and at the time, she had run off to be married to my father. In the first chapter of Until the Sea Shall Free Them, it reads, Clayton had two teenagers and a daughter in her 20s, now out of the nest. Teenagers always are a challenge, but it was the older girl's actions that bothered him and Mary, my grandmother. She wanted to marry a guy who was not in any way, shape, or form included on his lists, and Mary agreed. My mom would return home to her mother and siblings, once she divorced my father just 6 months after my birth. My father had run off with another woman whom he started a new family with. Though he ended up staying with his new wife and kids, I was lucky enough to be raised in a home full of overwhelming love by my mother, grandmother, and aunt. After so recently losing their father and husband at sea, I became a beacon of light, and the holidays were full of joy again. They spoiled me, really, but more than anything, they taught me love.
Love.
My mother eventually met my stepdad, Tommy, when I was in kindergarten. He was a motorboater who lived on his boat. Every weekend we would go down to the marina, and I would have the time of my life, racing dinghies, making toy boats out of styrofoam from old docks, and having so many exciting vacations, going to Allen's Harbor, Newport, Block Island, Martha's Vineyard, Boston, Montauk, nearly anywhere we could reach by sea. We even had a dog named Midnight that was born just a few slips down on a friend's boat. My childhood was really wonderful, though a little confusing at times. I was named Glenn Michael Fortin Jr. after my father. I was never called Glenn, though. For obvious reasons, I was referred to by my middle name. In fact, I remember distinctly the moment when I found out my first name wasn't Michael, but Glenn. I knew I had a name that was Glenn, I just thought that that was my middle name. I never really thought much of it all or how it affected me at the time. I was surrounded by love at home, but at school I always felt isolated from my peers. I'm not sure why exactly this was. It could be because I was raised as an only child or because the few times my biological father would pick me up, I'd feel very strange and ignored by him and my stepmom, especially in relation to my half-siblings. There was a lot going on that I didn't understand. My mother was going to college and later got a job to help support me, so my after-school life mainly consisted of watching TV and movies. I love watching movies over and over until I had them memorized. I had such a fascination with them and how they could so effectively convey such deep emotions, concepts, and perspectives. It gave me a connection to a world that I always have a sense of isolation from. In 1997, when I was 10 years old, I got my first black and white Tyco video camera.
Hello. Well, welcome to the Dare Usher Pride movie. Act 1.
I quickly made a flyer and had a bunch of kids from school come over to shoot a movie for extra credit. Everyone had a blast filming, and I spent many dedicated hours editing it using just two VCRs that I had hooked up together. At this time, this had never been done in my school. It became a habit of mine every semester to figure out how I could make a movie for some class to help boost my grades, but mainly, just so I had a reason to do it. It became such a popular idea that other kids began doing the same thing, and eventually, the teachers would just offer it up as an option whenever there was a project to do. So the competition began. I remember some people getting help from their fathers on how to pull off some really cool practical effects. I was teaching myself how to do things. But one day, my stepdad got me a copy of a new program that just came out, called Adobe Premiere. This was before digital video cameras were widely accessible, so everything was still recorded on VHS cassettes. But I had been able to find a card for my computer that was able to digitize the video so I could edit it in Premiere and spit it back out onto videotape. This changed the game. And in 8th grade, I made my first special effects heavy movie for English class. It was based on the film Mortal Kombat. Recently earned my black belt in karate, so along with the frame-by-frame animations and green screen effects, it was filled with lots of choreographed fight scenes. I was so proud to premiere that movie, and afterwards, I was more set than ever that this was what I was going to do for the rest of my life. More than anything, it was something that I was immediately good at, and it made me feel like I mattered. I continued making movies all through high school, but as my self-awareness advanced, I began to understand more and more the impact my father's abandonment was having on me. As that book about my grandfather stated when it began to introduce my mom, teenagers are always a challenge. But on a deeper level, it's the teenage years that are the challenge. Everyone develops their taste in music at this age. Though I really liked the Beach Boys in my early years, at this time, I started to gravitate more towards DMX. There's something so raw and honest I found about rap music. But more than anything, this is where I started to examine my feelings of abandonment. DMX's dad had left him too, and he talked about it a lot. But he took his situation and made it empowering, which he then spread to people like me. Eminem came next, and he did the same thing for me, but in an even more profound way. Cause one thing I never asked was when my dad be dead was, I guess he had trouble keeping up with every address, but I'd have flipped every mattress, every rock and desert cactus, own a collection of maps and follow my kid to the edge of the atlas. Someone ever moved. That's what hip-hop does. It takes the broken and gives them strength. I began writing my own poetry about my father. The first poem I wrote was called Stained and focused on the self-pity I felt from my father staining me with his name just before leaving me. I had won an award for my follow-up poem called Flesh and Blood, which went on to explain that our connection was nothing but that. But best of all, it went on to thank him for not being around, because by leaving me, he taught me how not to be. Mainly, how not to be a dad. And through that, I had found my own self-empowerment. Fast forward to about 20 years later, and here I am. My passion has become my profession. I'm about to get married to the love of my life, Megan. And this summer, we're expecting our first child, Lily Rose Griffin. I'm taking Megan's name so I can shed my stain, but also because her father was a hero who died in the line of duty, and she wants to hold on to his name. It's still a weird concept for me to wrap my head around that my name is gonna change, because I never pictured it would. Even though I was named after my father, it still means a lot to me because it's all I've ever known myself as. I've never really considered how crazy it is that women are traditionally just expected to do this. But I grew up in a household where my mother, stepdad, and I all had different last names, and I don't want that for Lily. I want her to have the strength of her true and full family unit behind her in every way possible. I feel like I've been waiting for this moment my entire life. I even picked the name Lily out when I was just 16 years old after watching the movie 8 Mile. Just don't tell Megan that's where it comes from. She's not even here yet and I can't stop thinking about her. All I do know is that I'm gonna teach that girl empowerment. But more than that, like my mom did for me, I'm gonna make sure that that little girl knows love beyond belief.